Hey guys, Russell here from homebrewrepublic.co.nz. We're going to check out the all new Black Rock Crafted Hazy. It's from their popular brew in a box range, and we're going to make two brews, a US style hazy and a New Zealand style hazy. Let's get into the video. Hey guys, Russell here from homebrewrepublic.co.nz. Welcome officially to the video and thanks for joining us. You already know that what we are checking out today is this kit right here. It is the Black Rock Crafted Hazy. It's from their really popular brew in a box range. So in terms of what the kit says we're going to get, we are going for an ABV, which is alcohol by volume, of 4.8%. So not quite a session style brew, but certainly not a heavy hitter. So it should be, in that sense, really, really enjoyable and fairly easy drinking. IBU, International Bitterness Units, is 28. Now, IBU is on a scale of 100. So at 28, I would consider that a really easy going bitterness level. And SRM 9, SRM is our color scale. So at 9, I would expect a really pale golden color to be coming through on this brew. What I'm going to do, normally I talk a bit up the front of the video and I generally talk about the history of brew styles or the ingredients that we're using. I'm going to keep it really brief before we actually get into the video. I'm still going to share all that good stuff, but what I'm going to do is share it during the course of the video when we're using the various ingredients or at the various process steps where the information is relevant. One thing I do want to do though before we start brewing is revisit these kits really, really quickly. So the brew in a box range are unique kits. They are the only kit of their kind on the New Zealand market like this. Black Rock call them a brew in a box kit, and for good reason. They are a brew in a box. They are exceptionally easy to use and they are exceptionally high quality kits. The first thing that I really love about these kits is they're the exact same product that is sold to professional microbreweries. So as we get it in this box, it's 4.5 kgs. The professional product or the commercial product is sold in 20 kg boxes. Other than that, it's the exact same product. All Black Rock has done is repackaged it for the consumer market. I think that's really, really cool. So what it means is, as brewers, we're putting our hands on the same product that the professionals are using. So as long as we get our process steps correct, largely in terms of temperature control and in terms of cleanliness, we're going to get something that is going to start getting really close to a professional quality brew. And I think that is so awesome. The next thing about this, and actually let's open up this kit and have a look. So these are simple and super easy to use. The first piece with this kit is there are no additional ingredients required. So with other kits where we're normally going for additional fermentables, whether that's a dextrose or a malt extract of some description, everything we need is in one bag here. Equally, it's easier to use, so there's no heating to soften up the malt before we transfer it into the fermenter. It's super easy. The jokes, or I don't know if I'd call them jokes, in general, it'll take you longer to clean your equipment before you set the brew up than it will to actually set the brew up. You can have one of these brews set up and fermenting within 5 minutes. And this kit, other than the extract that is in the bag itself, comes with everything you need, which in this case is the yeast to get this brew fermenting. The only additional ingredients that you're going to want are hops. Now, that brings me to a really critical point, and this will be probably the most important thing I say before we actually get into the brewing. What I would often do in a brew review is make two brews, a basics brew and a recipe brew, whereby the basics brew, we get the brew on or the kit on the simplest, cost-effective, most easiest way possible. And then we get a recipe approach on where we'll use additional ingredients and compare the results at the end. When I shared with Black Rock that I wanted to do this brew review, they came back to me and said, "We know that you like to do that. If we can make a suggestion, don't do that in this case." And their reasoning was, which is really good advice, so I'd encourage anyone watching this to think about this. they said that the hops are a critical part of creating, you know, of the hazy effect in the brew. So basically their strong recommendation that came from Black Rock is don't do this kit unless you dry hop, or if I positively frame that, whenever you use this kit, always dry hop. And what they suggested, instead of doing a basic brew, was just do two styles of hazies, which is basically pick up two different combinations of hops, and which is exactly what we've done. So I've gone and got three hops, which we're going to bring together to make a US style hazy, and again, another three hops, which are specific to New Zealand, and we're going to make a New Zealand style hazy. The key thing with hazies is go big on the hop profile here. And I'm doing what I said I wouldn't do, which was talk too much. I will come back to that point when we're putting the hops in. So you've probably got a lot of questions right now. What hops are we using? How are we putting them in? All that kind of stuff. I will cover that. For now, I'm going to say too much talking, not enough brewing. Let's get into the brew. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the garage. First official use of the Firmzilla 30 litre all-rounder. Pretty happy so far. We are hooked up to the temperature controller. Temperature controller is telling us 19.6. 20 degrees is lighting up on the firm strip, so they're aligned. That's a good thing. What I did is I pitched the yeast while I was setting this brew up, and normally I wouldn't be able to do that. The reason is because we use normally what I would do is be using a large amount of boiling water in the bottom of a fermenter. With this brew, I didn't need to use the boiling water, which essentially means that the final initial temperature of this brew was ideal pitching temperature, or at a good pitching temperature. So we were able to pitch straight away. And I guess that feeds into the idea that these kits are super easy to use and take a little bit of the process out for us, which is good. The yeast was the Safe Ale S33. Safe Ale, really, really awesome brand of yeast and well chosen by Black Rock in this case. And the Safe Ale yeast is a yeast. It's really well suited to big hoppy profiles and big fruity expressions, which is the exact description we're looking for out of a hazy by nature of what hazies are. They're often called juice bombs for that exact reason. They have massive hop forward profiles and massive juicy profiles. So very well suited yeast. Now, what we're going to do from here is I'm going to close this up. Actually, what I didn't talk to you about was fermentation temperature. The ideal fermentation temperature range for that yeast, the Safe Ale S33, is 18 to 24 degrees. What I've done is I've set the fermentation temperature for 22 degrees. So dual temperature controller will help us hold it there. As I said, currently at 19. So when I close this up over the next 6 to 12 hours, it'll bring itself up to temperature, and that is where we will hold. Now I'm going to come back on day 3 to put our hops in. Hops are going in two stages or two phases, day 3 and then day 7. I will tell you all about the hops on day 3. Catch you then. Welcome back to the garage. Ladies and gentlemen, we have been fermenting at 22 degrees. It is day 4 and it is hop day. Now what we have already in the fermenter, and I'll talk about that in a second, is 3 types of hops. We have the US Cascade, the Amarillo and the Mosaic. Now those are all US hops. So what we are going for with this brew is a big US style hazy. Now if we put those all together, because that is the most important bit, what we are going to get out of this brew is big citrus dominance. We are expecting a big citrus backbone, mostly coming through from that orange and that grapefruit. We're expecting layers of tropical and berry back notes, mango and those complex blueberry nuances, and definitely aromatic complexity, rich and varied. So this is going to be pretty awesome. Now in terms of the hops, what we have in there is 300 grams. So I mentioned earlier, this is my first use of the Firmzilla, and one of the things I wanted to do was start eliminating exposure to oxygen during my fermentation process. What I've done, and you don't have to go to the Firmzilla to do this, you'd be able to do this with other fermenters, I've pre-packaged the hops into hop socks. That's unusual for me because I have typically gone commando with my hops in the past. What I've also done, this little guy right here is a magnet. That is I honestly spent 2 hours on a magnet website, something I never thought I would do, but it's one of the biggest rabbit holes I've ever been down, and you wouldn't believe the variety of magnets that are out there. The amazing thing though is this little guy right there is 7 mils wide. He's tiny, he's smaller than my fingernail. However, he has 5 kgs of pulling power with his partner on the inside. So his partner on the inside is inside the hop sock, and it's been holding them out of the brew. So now, okay, that was me putting the first round of hops in. Now we're day 4. So I mentioned we have a total of 300 grams. That's 100 grams of each of the hops that I mentioned, Amarillo, US Cascade, Mosaic. I split them in equal quantities into those hop socks. So there's 50 grams of each, meaning there's 150 grams in each hop sock. If I'm being honest, I had meant to come in on day 3 and put that one down, but I didn't. So here we are,
day 4. What I'm going to do is come back on day 7 and put the second round in. If I'm being honest, fermentation looks, this is very unlike me, because normally I keep pretty close eye on my brews. There's not a good deal of fermentation activity in there. So either way, we're day 4 now. I'll come back on day 7 and I'll put that second round of hops down, and we will talk about the process from there. Catch you soon. Here we are, guys. Welcome back to the garage. Day 5, keep it short. Round 2, hops. Going in. And that is done. Right, process from here. Gonna let fermentation complete. Fermentation will be complete when gravity is constant for 2 days. I'll start checking at day 10. The $1 million piece, actually it's not even $1 million piece. Okay, key message, I am not cold crashing. I am wanting to get the full haziness out of that brew. So no cold crashing for me. I'll be lifting those hops out, transferring into a bottling bucket, and bottling. From there, we will do the standard bottle maturing and go to taste test.
Hey guys, brew day. This is the second brew for Black Rock Brew-in-a-Box Crafted Hazy IPA. This one is going to be our New Zealand style hazy. I'll come back to that more when we talk about the hops. For now, what I want to do is talk about the aeration or oxidation. I want to talk about rehydrating yeast and yeast nutrient. So what you, actually, I'm going to take a step back. I'm going to chuck a link up in the screen. I had an awesome conversation with a gentleman by the name of John. John is a certified beer judge. He gave me some really specific feedback. Go and check it out, because it is interesting feedback. And we're going to use some of that here. So the first one, what you will have seen me do is give this brew a really, really big mix up. I have talked about this on and off on other videos before, but I was really intentional here to make sure that I mixed it very vigorously to oxygenate the wort. And in the words of John, when we went back to that video, oxygen at the start of a brew is not only your friend, it's actually really critical for yeast health and yeast performance during fermentation. So that's what we've done here. Now, the second thing we've done, which I didn't do on my last brew, is I have rehydrated the yeast. Now, this is really interesting because Black Rock were really good enough to reach out and share some thoughts on this as well. Now, the yeast that we're using here is fermentous, and interestingly, on the instructions for the Brunner bag, the instructions are very clear to sprinkle the yeast on top of the wort to not go through the rehydration process. What the position from fermentus as a yeast brand is that yeast is designed to be pitched directly, that brewers can rehydrate if they want to. So I have done so in this case. The other view which came through, and Black Rock was good enough to share this, was to some degree the counter view to rehydrating yeast. So the risk of rehydrating yeast is we've introduced another process step, we've introduced another piece of equipment, we've introduced another area where there is potential for infection basically to be introduced to the brew. So I think the message there is, when you think about rehydration, hold all of the impacts in balance. But the key message as well, and I think this is what Brendan and Black Rock were trying to get across, is be really clear on the yeast that you're using and what is best for that yeast, because as Black Rock called out, fermentus as a yeast doesn't specifically need to be rehydrated, and then it's an optional step for the brewers. So we did, in this case, rehydrate the yeast, and it'll be interesting to see the differences in fermentation. I have also prepared a yeast nutrient. A yeast nutrient is just designed to aid in active fermentation and make sure that the yeast has the nutrients available to get the most out of fermentation. So both of those will be going into the wort. I'm gonna take this down to the garage and put it in now. Let's get that underway.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Day 4. Had all good intentions of being down here yesterday on day 3, but it did not happen. Signs of ongoing fermentation on the top of our brew. What do you say we get these hops in? Here we are, guys. In it goes. All right. Now, this is a bit different to what you saw me do off the last one. I'm using my standard fermenters, so Hopsock, which we did do last time. This time I've just used some unscented dental floss, which I've tied to the bag and will just sit over the edge like that as we put the lid back on. And which we will do now. Here we go. So what I'm going to do is hop in two phases. That was phase 1. In total, 300 grams of hops. Now, in this case, for our New Zealand Hazy IPA, we are going with a Riwaka, Nelson Savin, and a Motueka hop. All New Zealand hops, which is the requirement for our New Zealand Hazy. So what you saw me do upstairs is, number 1, sanitize. So I sanitized the hop sock and the dental floss before we used it. I didn't measure the hops. I used approximately half from each bag. So into this first phase, we have 150 grams of the total 300 we're going to use. Now, our Riwaka, very much an upbeat and distinctive profile on that hop, famous for its bold fruity aroma. A very much an intense fruity flavor dominated by grapefruit, often regarded as having slightly earthy or spicy undertones, balanced with tropical fruit flavors, particularly lime and passion fruit, strong, fresh, fruity hop presence. Nelson Savin, again, distinctive fruity hop. Very much the strong resemblance of white wine, thus the name Savin in the name, being reflective of a Sauvignon Blanc. Also regarded as very much a new age hop. Notes of gooseberry, grape, and tropical notes, again reflective of the wine there. Now, Motueka, that is an old favorite of mine and another standout New Zealand hop. It is indeed citrus forward. It is lime and lemon zest and tropical fruit flavors on the back. Bring all of those three together. What we have is an aroma profile backed by, led out by citrus and very much backed by tropical notes. That is going to flow through to our flavor profile with hints of wine-like freshness, but overall a highly fruitful and juicy flavor profile. Sounds 100% perfect for a hazy IPA, I say. All that said, I am going to be back on day 8. We will add the second round of hops and we will cover off finishing process there. Cheers, guys.
Welcome back to the garage, ladies and gentlemen. Round 2 of hops. Same again, 50 grams of each. And what we're going to do is gently place that in the brew. I'm also going to pull these guys out. lid back on. All right, from here, ladies and gentlemen, I will screw that lid up properly. We are going to leave this brew until gravity is constant for 2 days, at which point we will remove those hops, transfer to a bottling bucket and bottle. No cold crashing, no finings. Hazy is the destination of this brew. All that said, I think the next time I see you guys will be for the official taste test. Cheers, catch you next time. Welcome back, guys. The day has finally arrived. This is the official taste test for the Black Rock Crafted Hazy. Here we go. I'm gonna kick off with the New Zealand style Hazy, which was our second brew. Bottle, glass, pour. All right. There we go, guys. That right there is our Hazy. And if you ask me, it has come out absolutely stunner. So what we have from a color perspective is, as we were expecting, that really pale gold, slightly straw color, but unquestionably absolutely hazy. And it's really awesome. I didn't pour that very well, but what this normally pours with is this really, really awesome white head, and it generally has pretty good head retention. That was my pour right there. The aroma profile for this brew, unsurprising, is a massive, big, very strong, juicy flavor profile coming off the top. And the first thing you pick up is those citrus notes, but very much backed by a complex array of fruit notes there. Everything from just big, bold and fruity through to tropical. Which is very much perfectly our flavor profile starting to be described. We dry hopped this with 300 grams of dry hops, so we do have a really big hop forward flavor profile. Moving back into this, there's actually quite a thick, juicy flavor profile coming through, thick but smooth. So hop forward, big citrus, big bold fruity and tropical notes. Moving back into that juicy flavor continues right through to the back with a solid juicy note on the back and a really low level of bitterness. So what I would say with this is really big flavor profile, really thick flavor profile, but very, very smooth, and in that respect, easy to drink. So I would call this Hazy Nailed. It's come out spectacularly well in that respect. One of the things that, so I did less talking up the front of this video. One of the things which I would normally talk about is the history of beer styles, and hazies, interestingly, are they're a very modern beer style, and in the grand scheme of beer, they're very, very young. So in context, you know, you look at something like a stout, which has its origins going back into the 1800s, versus hazies, which are thought to have originated in the 2010s. So, you know, essentially we're talking about a 10 to 15 year old beer style in that respect. Now, hazies are essentially thought to have originated in the New England region of America. And I say of America, so the New England region, I think it was made up of 6 states. It's considered New England. It's on the east coast of the US. One of those states in particular is Vermont. Now, in Vermont, there is a brewery called The Alchemist, and in that brewery there's a head brewer called John Kimmich. Now that John Kimmich is generally credited for creating the hazy style, and in particular it was a brew that he had called the Heady Topper. So the Heady Topper is generally now regarded as being the birth of hazies, and since then That style has gained popularity worldwide and in particular has been embraced very strongly by New Zealand. Testament to which, you know, this kit in particular, but hazes in general, have been one of the biggest selling styles this year. So that is the broad history of hazies. If someone was saying, what are the characteristics of a hazy? Number one, massive big hop forward flavor profiles. So you're always going to get a big hop forward profile. Number two, juicy. So tending to focus on those juicy, big juicy hops, juicy and citrus. The next notable piece is, and I think the style generally results in a juicy flavor. So beyond, once you get beyond the hop profile, there does tend to be a juicy flavor profile on the back, almost like you're drinking a glass of orange juice. And then going back further, the final characteristic of a hazy or a typical hazy is a really, really low level of bitterness. And this kit in general hits those on the head. Going back in particular to the IBU, which was 28, IBU being International Bitterness Units, that is a low level of bitterness. So like I said, with this brew, which perfectly fits that, big hop forward character, juicy, thick, juicy flavor profile, but smooth, low level of bitterness. There we go, guys. Hazy nailed. So that's the New Zealand style brew. I'm super happy with that. I think the brew overall was a success. I think it's come out spot on to the way the kit was meant to come out. And I think it's come out very much in line with what you would expect, yeah, from a hazy in general. So success on that front. The next question though, what about our US brew? You guys didn't see me open that bottle, but I have right here my brand new Homebrew Republic stainless steel bottle opener. Super proud of that one. So this is our US brew, which was actually our first one. So, good little pop coming through there, bottle, glass, pour. Now this, guys, is where I am going to be heading into confession territory. Right. There we go, guys. What I would just call out, I missed the head on the last one, so really nice clear white head. But if you look at that, you might argue good looking beer, but we're missing the hazy. So this is where I need to step into confession territory. Can I say that? I messed up. I was going to say a different word, you'll get the idea. When I brewed this brew, that was the first brew I did using the Firmzilla 30 liter all-rounder. And essentially what I did, I'm embarrassed to say, you can heckle me in the comments if you need to, I do deserve it. I misfitted the airlock. And what I mean by misfitted was essentially the mechanism inside that airlock is a little bit different and I didn't put enough water in. How I didn't spot that, how I didn't do anything about it is another question, but needless to say, it just was a cock up. And essentially this is the outcome we've got as a result of that. So if you look at these two brews, the New Zealand style hazy and the US style hazy, other than using different fermenters, we did essentially the exact same thing, right? We used the same amount of hops, albeit different hop varieties. We used different hops. But we did the exact same thing. And so essentially what we can see now, despite basically following the same recipe approach, we've got two completely different brews. So the impact of me making that epic and really just beyond explainable mistake is that I've ruined this brew. So when I say ruined, this is actually still drinkable. If you really wanted to drink it, you could. The impact of me not having the airlock on correctly means that this brew was exposed to oxygen throughout the fermentation process. And if you listened particularly to the video we made with John from Black Rock, he really emphasized the impact that oxygen can have on brews. And at the beginning of a brew, oxygen is needed. It's necessary to start healthy fermentation. But at the end of fermentation, oxygen is the enemy. It will, at the very least, it will destroy hop character, which is very much what it's done here. And worst case, what it will do is create the risk of infection coming into your brew and ruining the whole brew. So where I got lucky is that there was no infection into this brew. So the brew is actually, I wouldn't say it tastes bad. I would just say it's not what it's meant to be, right? So if we think about a hazy, this is what I would expect from a hazy. This, if I drink it now, it's not that it tastes bad. I would just probably be confused about what I was drinking. It's, you know, that looks a bit more like it's meant to be a lager or a pale ale. It does actually have a bit of a juicy flavor to it. It's obviously lost, it's pretty much lost entirely its hop character. We're about 2.5 months now. I did actually try this very early on, like at 10 days. And at that point, it was still okay. It was a lot better than what it is now. It did actually still have some haze and it did actually have some of that hop character. So I got a sense of what it would have been like and it was great. Obviously different to this other brew, the New Zealand brew. The hops we used were different, Amarillo, Cascade, and Mosaic. Mosaic's one of my favorite hops, big depth of flavor, a lot of complexity to it, but really, really nice. So this brew actually initially came out really nice, but it's got to where it is. So what's interesting as well, and we talked about this earlier on, is, you know, Black Rock said to us the importance of hops in this brew, and in particular, the use of hops during the dry hopping process, supporting the haze and the hazy effect that is created. So I, in some respects, I'm kind of glad that I made the mistake, because it's shown how this brew may have come off if hops weren't used from the outset. And I think one of my learnings having done this is I wouldn't do this kit without hops. I think you would wind up with something like this, and I think it would be not getting the most from the kit by any stretch. Like I said, if I really didn't want to waste it, it's still drinkable, but not what it's meant to be, and certainly not the best it can be. Yeah, so lesson learned, and won't be doing that again. I do want to come back to these kits and talk a little bit more about these kits. And I've kind of said this throughout the video, but these are great kits, and there's also nothing else like them on the New Zealand market. One of the things I love most about these is, and Black Rock has said, that these are the same product they sell into commercial microbreweries. They've just repackaged it for the consumer market. And the thing I love about that, which I said earlier, is that what these kits do is they put a professional quality product into our hands as home brewers. And done right, done wrong, you get this, but done right, you get this, which is an absolutely fantastic brew and is hazy, pale, hazy nailed, basically. One of the things and probably a little bit of testament to that as well, is Black Rock put a post up on their Facebook page maybe a month ago now, and the Dunedin Wine and Food Festival was on. And so the post was a video, and what they did, I assume it was a cell phone, they went into their microbrewery and the shot was, whatever the number was, it was 20 or 30 of these kits getting ready to go into a microbrewery setup to brew 1,000 litres that was going to be poured on tap at the Dunedin Wine and Food Festival. And I think that's great. I mean, the point that I took was that this is the product. This product can produce a professional quality outcome that they were prepared to serve on tap at a major public event. So all we need to do as brewers is get right our basic processes, not like me, with our equipment, with our cleanliness, with our sanitization, with our bottling and our storage, and we're going to get a great product that we can be proud and share with our friends. I also think, and so cheers Black Rock, I think, for that video, because I think that was an awesome way to essentially back your own brand to take this product, noting that that was going into a microbrewery, which is a professional setup, but actually using this product and serving it at that event, it is testament to the quality of this. I also think, I don't want to understate the actual thought that Black Rock has put into not just the quality of the product, but, you know, we talked a bit about yeast, and I don't think it's any by accident that the Safe Ale C3 is in here. And if I go back to the Safe Ale instructions, the instructions were really, really clear that that yeast is fine to be sprinkled directly on top of the brew. And if brewers choose, they could choose to rehydrate, but it's not necessary. And I think the point there is that Black Rock's put some thought into this kit to make sure it is the easiest to use in a home brewing environment. And in that sense, that yeast is really perfect. And one of the things I do believe, like I think, and particularly, and Black Rock have said this to me in a different conversation, that one of the areas or one of the things these kits will do is make it far easier for newer brewers in particular to get a great brew straight off the bat. As long as you can get some basics right around temperature control and around cleanliness, you are going to get a really good result. So overall, I'm a big fan of the Hazy. I think they've nailed the kit from a Hazy and from a style perspective. I'm also a big fan of these kits in general. And of course, they don't just have the Hazy in this range. There's a Pale Ale, a Golden Ale, an IPA. That IPA in particular, I've done a review on that, and that to this day is one of my favorite kits.
Yeah,
but like I said, there's a range across these kits. So that's enough love going to Black Rock. What else have I been brewing? Lots, really. I'm way behind. Actually, I'm always way behind on content, but I've got another Black Rock kit, which was a stout, and it was a second attempt at my coffee stout. The second one in my mind came off way better than the first. That'll be one of the next videos we drop. I've got a pale ale. That one was really interesting because what we did was we cold steeped for the first time. That brew has come out really well. I've got my third wine down, an Italian Pinot Grigio. Fermenting now, smells pretty good. And key thing for me is I'm weeks away from Christmas, and I'm right on the back foot here. So next week I'm getting two brews down. I'm gonna try the brand new, so basically my Christmas lineup, three brews, the Italian Pinot Grigio, then I want two beers, and I'm gonna use the brand new Black Rock Extra Pale Ale. I'm gonna hop that with about 150 grams of hops. The other brew I'm going to go to is a dry lager, and I'm going to use the Brick Row dry lager. So that's those three there, that Italian Pinot Grigio, the extra pale ale with a nice hoppy character, and then the dry lager, crisp, clean, and light body. That's where I'm going, and those are going to be my Christmas and January drinks. If you like what we do, thanks guys. Appreciate you watching this far. Give us a thumbs up. We really appreciate the support. We've got a really active group on Facebook. It's Homebrew Republic Kit Brewers. You can check out our website. It's homebrewrepublic.co.nz. You'll find on the homepage, if you scroll down, there's actually a link off to the Facebook group to make it easy to find. But there's a bunch of great people in there who are really into their brewing, and a real mix of people. Everything from people brewing their first brews through to guys and girls that have been doing it for years and always happy to chat about recipe ideas or what they're up to and stuff like that. But all that said, I think I've been talking more than enough for today. So I'm going to say thank you for watching. We will catch you next time. Cheers.